Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Growth of the economy, the employment rate, Zozos and SOEs, prices at our supermarkets, gas prices, are all topics that many of us will readily engage in and have even heated discussions on. But when it comes to the quality of the air we breathe, the level of pollution of our rivers, our streams, our gullies, and other waterways, usually it's only a small number of informed voices that will engage in this discussion. And what can possibly be attributed to that is many persons do not know much about the state of our environment, the state agencies that are responsible for regulating our environment, as well as the successes and challenges that they have encountered. I am Nicole Walker, Director of Programs at CAPRI, and welcome to our public forum to launch our report on the State of Jamaica's Framework for Environmental Management. The research that informed this report was carried out under the project Actions for Strengthening Good Governance and Accountability in Jamaica, funded by the USAID through the National Integrity Action. We are extremely grateful to both project partners for their support. We hope that the findings and recommendations from the report will increase your knowledge and enable informed discussions on the subject. To lead the discussion we have with us this evening, the Honorable Daryl Vaz, Minister without Portfolio in the Ministry of Economic Growth and Job Creation, Professor Dale Weber, Principal of the UWI Mona, Dr. Diana Thorburn, CAPRI's Director of Research, Ms. Dana McCauley, CAPRI's Affiliate Researcher, and Ms. Denise Forrest, Managing Director, Forrest and Associates. The discussion will entail presentation of the findings by Dr. Thorburn, brief comments from our panelists, and then questions and answers. This will be moderated by Ms. Danielle Andrade, a partner at Gough Law. We at CAPRI are delighted to have you here this evening, and we look forward to an engaging discussion. Do enjoy the conversation. I'd like to now invite Dr. Patrice Charles, NIA's Deputy Executive Director, to share remarks.
Honorable Daryl Vaz, Mrs. Diana McCauley, good to see you again. Professor Dale Weber, Ms. Denise Forrest, Director of Research at CAPRI, Dr. Diana Thorburn. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Once again, the National Integrity Action is happy to welcome yet another report by CAPRI. This is the fourth report conducted under the NIA CAPRI sub-awardee partnership. Part of NIA's mandate is to build citizen awareness, but not just any awareness. We want to build awareness based on evidence, data, and research. Our hope and mission is to grow an awareness that would form part of the foundation of a more assertive citizenry. You know, I recall being a college student back in the days and having my father advise me that I should study environmental management and public health. And he kept insisting, you know, you should go for environmental management and public health because according to him, the environment will eventually become a major concern of all governments around the world as it relates to health and sustainability of every human being on our planet. That was in 1996. You fast forward, and we're now in 2018, and here I am. At the revealing of the results of research on the review and assessment on aspects of Jamaica's planning and environmental legislative and enforcement framework. And yes, my father was absolutely right in his vision of the future. And don't tell him, but I'm glad I listened to him. I did my first doctorate in public health with a specialty in environmental management. And my thesis was truly an eye-opener for me. In 1999, it revealed the then inadequacies and lack of resources of the government environmental watchdog agencies. And unfortunately, 17 years later, very little has changed in regards to their ability to protect and sustain our natural environment, whilst taking into consideration the public's health. The quality of the natural environment and climate control, or even the public health of our country, should never be seen as just a fad, the popular thing to speak about at the moment, or a figment of a mad scientist's imagination. I won't say who said that. It's a very real necessity, because the quality of our lives depend on the quality of our natural environment. For us to become that prosperous nation that we hear our government speak of, we all will need development. Can't get around it. We need development. We will need the commercial industry, and we will need healthy citizens to contribute to the workforce. And thus, we need to ensure that a balance is created to guarantee that we will have both development and environmental sustainability. A big contributor to achieving that balance are the government agencies that are designated as our environmental watchdogs, who are also the enforcers of the environmental laws. They are our protectors. However, if the environmental regulations are ineffective and outdated, then the enforcers will have little or nothing to use to protect the public's health and a natural resource of our nation. I must say that I see evidence, though very little, at an attempt to increase the budget of the environmental agencies, and for that the government should be congratulated. For the fiscal year 2017-18, I noted from the estimates of expenditure, NEPA received a budget of approximately $840 million. And for the fiscal year 2018-19, it had slightly increased to approximately $956 million, with an estimated further increase to just over $1 billion for the 2019-20 fiscal year. NSWMA also had slight increases. Both budgets, however, and even when you say, wow, just over $1 billion, you think, yes, that's a lot of money. That should be, you know, they should be good with that. The truth is, both budgets are minimal in comparison to the necessary resources, and that includes human resources that is needed to create efficient and effective agencies. Now, as I mentioned earlier, creating awareness is one of NIA's key mandates. The fact that there is evidence through the results of the Environmental Performance Index that we are getting worse, not better, is grounds to sound the alarm louder than ever before. The Environmental Performance Index ranked 180 countries according to their performance in safeguarding ecosystems and protecting human health from environmental harm. In 2016, Jamaica ranked 54 out of 180 countries. We have not improved in regards to our performance on the high priority environmental issues, especially in the areas of protection of human health and protection of the ecosystems. In 2018, just 2 years later, we ranked 78. And though this is better than some of our Caribbean neighbors, such as Barbados and Bahamas and Haiti, we're still trailing behind Cuba, and Dominican Republic, and St. Vincent and the Grenadines, just to name a few. What's required is a more sustained and focused effort on the part of the government of Jamaica, our public authorities, civil society, and groups. One outstanding example of this engagement by civil society was the petition initiated by JET and supported by NIA. Can I tell you, Diana? I don't know what this country would do without JET, because you are seriously the voice of the environment in bringing awareness for the environment, and truly, I have to congratulate you, and thank you. JET petitioned, and as everyone knows, because they got so many signatures, for the cockpit country and the preservation of its important water sources for mining. Action taken, awareness created, impact achieved. A Again, I'd like to make mention of signs that we are moving in the right direction. Slowly, but we are. There are some of our large manufacturing companies that have moved to reduce the percentage of plastic used in their bottles to lessen the environmental impact. Alas, they're using less plastic. No problem, 50% less. Our citizens are, however, still unlawfully dumping the 50% less plastic bottles in our gullies and streets, which ends up creating an even bigger environmental impact. I also appreciate the efforts of some of our restaurant chains who have now moved away from styrofoam to the use of cardboard boxes. Our citizens must also get on board. It can't just be government. It can't just be our civil society. The citizens really need to get on board and build back up their civil pride. I was driving home and a taxi was in front of me. His window was down. He was drinking from a plastic bottle, probably 50% less plastic. And he was finished with it, main road, you know, not even a little side road, on the main road. And it was nothing for him to just throw it out the window. And I just said to myself, there is clearly, absolutely no civil pride in that man. Because if I have a piece of paper in my hand in my car, it stays in my car until I get to my destination where I can throw it away. Because I just wouldn't, if my children ever threw something out the car, I'd pull over and they would have to go and pick it up. So our society, our citizens, we really need to develop our civil pride. Because a lot of the garbage and the refuge would be easier controlled if it was managed from inside our homes and disposed of properly and lawfully. This evening, I'm looking forward to the vast knowledge of information and advice that will be shared with us by the panel. I'm certain that they will provide insight, information into what is needed to improve our environmental status, which will eventually lead to an improvement in the public's health. I look forward to it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Charles. I'll now invite Dr. Thorburn to share the findings and recommendations from the report.
Sean Paul, I'm sure you're wondering what he has to do with the environmental governance framework for Jamaica. Last month, he sounded the alarm that a welding plant had been built adjacent to the stadium swimming pool. And he was upset because the toxic fumes from the welding plant were affecting the hundreds of children and other people who use that pool every single day. After a number of posts on Instagram and letters, public letters, he eventually paid out of his pocket to have the welding plant relocated. I imagine he got to that point because in trying to find out why the welding plant was there, he couldn't understand who would have authorized it, who was responsible for having it removed, and who was to pay for its relocation. So he just got the job done. This is why we are here this evening. My name is Diana Thorburn. I'm the Director of Research at Capri. And we wanted to ask the question and answer the question, why, after so many years, are we not managing our natural environment and our natural resources in the way that we should? Being concerned about the stewardship of our natural environment is not the purview of tree-hugging environmentalists. It is a mainstream concern. It is a concern for us all. It is embodied in our National Development Plan, Vision 2030. It's one of the four pillars of the plan. We don't have to be environmentalists to have a vested interest in whether our air is safe to breathe, or that we have clean, safe, and healthy beaches and rivers. But we are not practicing the stewardship necessary to ensure that our island's beauty and natural resources, in all of its functional and aesthetic roles, are sustained for ourselves and our children, and for our children's children.
These are not protests made by the tree huggers. These are reported in our own government's reports and have been for over 30 years. They are not new problems, nor are there problems that we're not aware of. What we have not done is address them in a concerted and comprehensive manner. And hopefully with this report and this research and sharing these findings, we're going to move a step forward to getting to that point. Let us think of the context in which our natural environment is managed as a basket. And as baskets go, it's woven together with different strands, different fibers, in this case, sticks. And each of these sticks and each of these fibers is themselves wound together and held together with other bits of fiber. But this basket, the one we have in Jamaica for our environment, is not only porous, as baskets are, but it is not well constructed. Many of the strands, the sticks are weak. The fibers that hold them together are not intact. Many of the sticks do not extend all the same way. And what this report and this research has told us is that there are three ways that we can understand why this basket is not serving us. First, a confusing regulatory framework. Second, incomplete laws and regulations and policies. And third, a lack of accountability. Our confusing regulatory framework begins with the fact that our environmental portfolio has not had a steady home. Since 1991, it has fallen under 13 different ministries, 11 different ministers, including two prime ministers. There is no continuity in policy. There is no ability to retain institutional memory or expertise. Often, the environmental ministry is placed in the same ministry as that with other mandates, often competing mandates, such as tourism or housing, which can lead to conflicts of interest. And to date, unfortunately, the environmental mandate has lost. Since the change in administration in 2016, portfolio responsibility for the environment falls under the Ministry of Economic Growth and Job Creation and the Office of the Prime Minister. The de jure environmental minister, therefore, is a prime minister, but he has delegated his responsibilities to Minister Without Portfolio, who is with us this evening. Setting the location of the environmental portfolio aside, we have a complex, confusing, and opaque regulatory framework. There are some two dozen laws related to the environment, administered by over two dozen different state entities that span over half a dozen government ministries. What this ends up with is multiple entities can be responsible for different aspects of the same environmental issue, which leads to overlap, as well as a great ability to shirk responsibility from one agency or entity to another. Classic example, if you have burning garbage next door, you may call NEPA. They may tell you to call the Ministry of Health, who may then tell you to call the fire brigade. Typical example. In addition to all of these laws and institutions and entities that are responsible, there are over 20 environment-related policies, the majority of which are in draft or have not been finalized, have been expired and are being revised. And the few policies that have been finalized, we're not following them. Case in point, in 2016, Jamaica finalized an overwater room policy. And in that same year, a major hotel chain was approved to begin construction on overwater hotel rooms. That policy is now being revised. The complexity and opacity of our governance framework is not a new issue. As Dr. Charles said many years ago when she did her doctoral thesis, this was virtually what she found. But this has been going on for at least 30 years of what the government itself has recorded in various reports on the state of our natural environment. Another aspect of the confusion is the structure within which the environment is regulated and the entities that enforce the regulation. In 2001, the three main regulatory bodies, the Natural Resources and Conservation Authority, the Town and Country Planning Authority, and the Land Development and Utilization Commission, merged to create NEPA. However, the Act for NRCA was never repealed, and the new NEPA Act was never promulgated. That means that NEPA is operating under multiple laws that predate the organization with no legislation giving it legal authority to actually enforce any of these regulations. It ends up being that the NRCA, who responds directly to the minister, instructs NEPA, and the NEPA itself also responds directly to the minister. In 2011, the government released a concept paper that outlined a new entity, essentially to complete the NEPA process that had been left unbirthed. The process was never completed, and from what we gathered from our research here, it appears to be off the books. The second aspect of this weak basket is that even where we have policies, they have either not been finalized or are not used or followed. Development orders are one of the most important planning tools. They guide development in the cities, towns, parishes, and other specifically designated areas to which it applies. They specify things like how high buildings can be, how far from the road the setback needs to be, and how much space should be between buildings. These are administered by our parish municipal authorities, what we used to call parish councils. Development orders do not exist for many areas throughout Jamaica. And where they do exist, many of them have not been updated for decades, allowing development to take place in a planning vacuum. And even where they do exist, they are often breached. Negril has a good development order and has had one for many decades. Some of us are familiar with it. No hotels over 3 stories, for example. But if you go to Negril now, you'll see 6-story hotels. And many other examples that are openly breaching the development order for Negril. There's currently a process underway to create development orders for the entire island, but for the areas where development orders did not exist, a lot of development has taken place, which has not only been bad for the natural environment, but has been haphazard. Portmore is a prime example where 3 decades of massive development has taken place without a development order. It is getting a development order, which is in process now. Similarly, we do not have a comprehensive national spatial plan. We had 2 national physical plans, but they seldom guided development or environmental management. In 2009, 8 years ago, the government started the process towards a national spatial plan to do as spatial plans do, establish clear priorities, identify areas in which particular types of land use would be encouraged and others prohibited, example, no-build zones, guide the development of transport routes, residential accommodation, industrial development, and conservation of the built and natural environment, quote from the recommendation from the government. That process, which was conceptualized in 2009, was launched this year, 9 years later, with funding from the IDB. 7 technical papers funded by the CDB were commissioned and are said to be in train to be completed by June 2019. However, as we saw with the development orders, without an implemented and or enforced physical plan, as we had obtained, a vacuum has been created, a vacuum was created in which illegal developments were proliferated throughout the island. This has obtained in most of our major resort towns, Montego Bay, Otorias, Negril, where, as just one example, the problem of housing for hotel industry workers has caused not only environmental damage, but also public health and security issues. A strategic environmental assessment is similar to a national spatial plan in the sense that it gives a large plan for a large area. It assesses large geographical areas with a view to mitigating environmental risks in policies, plans, and programs, and the cumulative impacts of development on a particular region, for example, a national park or city or town. It's comprised of comprehensive or long-term considerations of the environmental impact of a development should it go beyond an individual development or project. So an EIA environmental impact assessment for one hotel, SIA for an entire strip where hotels may be built. So whereas 1 or 2 developments may have low environmental impacts on their own, a number of projects may have significant cumulative impacts, which make the whole greater than the sum of its parts. We have had SAAs done, but they have not generally been followed. And in many important cases, SEAs have not been done, for example, for the North-South Highway, which, though it traversed the entire island, serious considerations of the geology of the area were not fully taken on. And even before it was finished, one heavy rain caused US $6 million worth of damage to the resort village at Old Fort Bay. A strategic environmental assessment policy was developed by NEPA in 2003, but it remains in draft. EIAs are done to estimate the environmental impact of a single project or development. There's no mandatory requirement for environmental impact assessments under Jamaican laws. These are done if they're required by NEPA upon the application that a developer submits. But the environmental impact assessment process, as we have it in Jamaica, is very flawed because it's up to the applicant, the developer, to commission an EIA and to pay for that EIA. So the consultant who is conducting the EIA for that developer is not very likely to say that the project should not go ahead. There have been suggestions to mitigate this conflict of interest. We'll come back to those as we get to the recommendations. Another important weakness of the EIA process in that in Jamaica, we don't have a standard qualification for EIA consultants. So essentially, anybody can call themselves an EIA consultant, conduct an environmental impact assessment, and that's what we're working with. Finally, there are others, but importantly, is that we lack robust baseline data. Basically, if we're proposing a project and saying it's going to have X impact on a body of water, we actually don't have data to say what the water was in the first place to say that this development is going to have X impact on it. And finally, again, we'll come back to this, is the inaccessibility of EIAs to the public. The third aspect of our environmental regulatory framework, which makes that basket so weak, is insufficient penalties for breaches of environmental laws. These are compounded by the lack of accountability at all levels of Jamaica's environmental governance. The penalties and fines for not applying for permits, for breaching permits, for breaking laws, for lack of compliance with laws or permits are not, as you can see, very useful disincentives. The fines in many instances are so low that it would suit a developer to continue as they were doing, pay the fine, and rather than stop what they were doing and not be able to proceed. We understand that there is a process underway to increase fines and penalties, and the Town and Country Planning Act was revised recently, and it has more stringent fines and penalties from $25,000 to $1 million. However, these are only imposed on conviction in the residence magistrate court, which leads us to our next challenge, which is the lack of enforcement. So even if a fine is imposed and successfully gets through the legal system after however many years, sometimes 10, 15 years, even then, sometimes the breaches that have taken place are pardoned or excused or forgiven in some way. So even though breaching a development order or a permit can result in a stop notice, an enforcement notice which can require demolition of buildings and the restoration of land, it's seldom carried out. But some of you might remember the building just down the road here on South Avenue at the corner, which was illegally built. It took 15 years for that building to come down after the first ruling was handed down that it should come down, 15 years. And the building that we see here, many of you might recognize as having gone up in the 1980s. It was three stories higher than the permit allowed. And the KSAC at the time ordered them to take off the top four floors. Long story from there, but this building was recently sold by the government and has been refurbished and is now in operation as Dodge and Towers. The consequences of breaches to permits seldom result in permits being withdrawn. And where we have breaches by our own state agencies generally going unpunished, it leads to just a general lack of enforcement and a culture of impunity in breaking environmental laws. The weakness of the accountability mechanism is manifest in the NRCA Act itself, the NRCA Act being our main environmental law. and the broad discretionary powers that it gives the portfolio minister. The regulations of the Act allow for ministerial discretion to give directions of a general character regarding policy and performance of the NRCA's functions. The minister has wide powers to vary or uphold decisions and does not have to give reasons. There is no explicit right of appeal contained in the Act for the public to object to the granting of permits or licenses or to challenge your conditions, and the minister's decision is final. Finally, and importantly, our environmental governance framework does not allow the public to have a say. As individual citizens, we have little right to participate in or have any say in what's going on around us with our built environment or our natural environment. Citizens who are directly affected by decisions, actions, and inactions have little access not only to protest them, but for information to have any recourse to protest or participate in these actions. For development orders, they are dense, lengthy documents, they're not accessible. Beyond publishing a notice in the newspapers, there's no requirement for the general public to be consulted about the contents of that order. Similarly, EIAs tend to be very complex, technical, and often scientific documents, and there's no requirement that they be shared with the public. How then do we move from this basket to something that serves us better? A more efficient, responsive, participatory, and effective way of managing our natural environment. We have some recommendations. First, we're going to move away from a basket, something that is going to hold us all together in a more cohesive way. First is to promulgate the NEPA Act as a matter of urgent priority. This is something that simply needs to be done. The confusing and contradictory regulatory framework we have now cannot continue. It's a key source of the weaknesses and problems that we face. We need to complete the remaining development orders for the rest of the island and conduct outreach on their provisions so people, not only developers, citizens, are also aware of what is being said is going to happen in their own town, in their own community. Similarly, we need to fast track the National Spatial Plan, which is said to be in the works. Developers and investment agencies should be able to review this so that in any framework for development going forward, they're able to consult this and see how we intend to go forward as an island. We need to complete and promulgate the environmental impact assessment regulations. As I pointed out the weaknesses earlier, there are many. We need to rationalize and complete the nearly 20 incomplete environmental policies, and we need to follow them. We need to increase fines and sanctions. We need to settle the location of the environment portfolio. It needs to stay in one ministry. We have a number of ideas. The Ministry of Health is a possibility, the Ministry of Local Government. The Office of the Prime Minister has so far proven to not be a bad home for it. We need to establish a parliamentary commission on the environment, similar to the Office of the Children's Advocate or the Electoral Commission. And finally, we recommend exploring the feasibility of an environmental court for Jamaica. There's been an explosion of environmental courts and tribunals all over the world, including in our neighboring Caribbean country, Trinidad and Tobago, where we could learn from their experience as to establishing our own environmental court. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope that you will have learned something from the report that we have shared and the research that we have shared, and that we can all move together with this greater awareness to creating a bowl instead of a basket to protect our natural environment.
Thank you, Diana, for that insightful and fascinating research. I would like to invite you to please take a seat. My name is Danielle Andrade, and as mentioned before, I'm an attorney at law with the firm Goff Law. I've specialized in environmental law, so much of what was said during this discussion
kind of resonated and hit home with me, but I certainly found that there was some information in there that I did not know, and it was interesting to learn. So I'm going to invite our esteemed panelists to help share their views and perspectives on the findings of this report, and perhaps during the course of our discussion, we can mesh out what should be the proper bowl and not the basket for environmental regulation in Jamaica. I would like to invite first to join me Honorable Daryl Vaz, Minister without Portfolio in the Ministry of Economic Growth and Job Creation, with responsibility for the land, environment, climate change, and investments. Mrs. Diana McCauley, Affiliate Researcher at CAPRI. Professor Dale Weber, Principal of University of West Indies, Mona. And last but not least, Ms. Denise Forrest, Managing Director, Forrest and Associates. Please welcome our panelists.
Thank you.
So, just to explain the format for this panel discussion, I'll be inviting the panelists for 5 minutes to share with us their perspectives on the findings. And after each of them, 5 minutes, and we have a timekeeper in the audience, I will remind you, so bear that in mind. After those 5 minutes, then we'll open up the floor for questions and answers. So we'll all get our opportunity, we'll get a chance to pick the brains and minds of our panelists. So I understand that Minister Vaz may have to leave early, so I'll begin with him. Minister Vaz, please share with us
your views. Thank you very much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Let me first say that Diana's presentation was outstanding because it basically gave a good overview of the major issues that have been faced with the environment and the environmental regulations over the last 3 decades. Thankfully, I only have about 4 years out of that 30 years with responsibility for it, so I won't take full blame, but it really was fantastic. And what I want to say is that for you, the audience, the recommendations that have been put forward are very simple and straightforward. But for me, who has a responsibility, it's going to require a lot more discussions with Diana and CAPRI to work through what we can do in relation to looking at the thing holistically and looking at what we can do in the short term, medium term, and long term, because we've already gone 30 years and you can see that we really have not made much progress in terms of some of the systemic problems that we have. I'm happy to say that based on the report that I had the good fortune to get a copy of before, that a lot of what was indicated in terms of the promulgation of the Act and of course the environmental impact assessment regulations and the rationalization and complete draft environmental policies, all of those are on track for 2019-2020 financial year. The development orders, since we came to office in 2016, we have actually published quite a bit, and the rest of them are to be done within the next financial year as well. So that in a sense is good news, but that is only a small part of the overall presentation that was made. And I think that as we have done with CAPRI in terms of, even as we speak, the deposit refund scheme, which we're hoping to roll out as part of the ban on plastics and styrofoam, those discussions continue, and CAPRI played a critical role in some of the recommendations and kind of mediated between the manufacturers, exporters, and the government. And that is a sort of role that I'm hoping that we can go forward with this base document that has been created, because it is, even from a layman's perspective, it is simple and it is accurate. You cannot deny what has been put forward there. in relation, Diana, to the housing of the environment portfolio. I see what you have said in terms of the amount of different ministries that it has been housed in. I would have to say, being objective, between 2007 and 11, when it was housed under Prime Minister Gowling and now Prime Minister Honus, that we have seen some serious impacts in terms of results. And I think the environment and climate change is such a critical issue in terms of the whole economic growth and job creation ministry that we have formed, that I think it has the importance to remain under the Prime Minister. Unfortunately, he doesn't have the time, obviously, to deal with all of them. That's why you have ministers without portfolio, like myself. But I would say definitively. So, in essence, ladies and gentlemen, the most important thing is to accept assistance and professional help. When ministers believe that they know everything, which they are not qualified in the particular field, and they start to take decisions, that's when trouble starts. So we have a great team. Capri is doing an excellent job. And guess what? I embrace them, and that's why I'm here this evening. The bottom line is to show not only my support, but the administration's support under Andrew Honus, that this is a type of partnership that we need to build, and we must respect it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister Vaz, for those words. And I would love to now invite, perhaps, Diana, we can go to Professor Weber, since you've done the presentation. Professor Weber, please, your 5 minutes responding to the findings.
Thank you, and good evening to you all. This report, for me, is most interesting. I had to congratulate you as I sat down, because I thought you presented it very well in layman's terms, as well as getting enough details within. It reminds me of a lecture I gave to a couple of my students who I see here, where I started by saying, the environment is an interesting thing. Left alone, the environment could manage itself. Environmental management is not about managing the environment. It's managing man's impact on the environment. Mm-hmm. And we're still at that stage trying to do that. So the University of the West Indies has a strange role to play in that we are in charge of teaching, research, and outreach. And the environment has been at the center of a lot of what we wanted to do. It is our research that has helped us recognize that Jamaica has many ecosystems. And by that many ecosystems, we have high biodiversity. And therefore, we have endemism. We therefore need to put everything in place to try and protect that. This report speaks to what we have done or not done, despite our having had the information at our fingertips. What we do need to do is to continue producing the information. But nobody wants to document continued deaths. You want to be able to continue monitoring as things change, and we have an opportunity to import the change that we need into our lives on a day-to-day basis. Jamaica is probably one of the most signed countries in terms of international conventions, and it was thought that this would have been the tool, the leverage that we would use. Ramsar, UNFCCC, UNCLOS, Cartagena, MARPOL. We've signed everything that's come before us, but have we used it? Have we been able to use it in our local legislation? I leave that for the discussion. But the issue of the NRCA Act, that act actually was the most powerful act when it was first put on the table. An act that starts by saying it binds the crown means, given the right circumstances, the NRCA can arrest the prime minister. Don't think they would try it, but it does mean that we should hold our governments responsible. And I'm not sure we've been able to do that consistently. Governments go where people take them. And I think we, as a people, have not done enough, have not said enough to take the governments to where we want them to go. So I think self-regulation would allow us to do better regulation of those in charge of us. As we look at what we do in terms of framework, I would like to see more environmental economics and environmental law. Right, Daniel? Because those are features that I think reach those who are certainly the developers. As someone who has done EIAs and taught students how to do EIAs, done SEAs, you provide the information and you worry. Because my professor used to tell me, we're a strange country. We see the obvious, realize it to be the evident, and often do the opposite. Why would we choose to step away from the things that we recognize to be so? We've tried the name and shame, but how far does it take us? We've tried getting more information, and until the Access to Information Act became more and more used, right, Diana? We wouldn't know what was out there or what was in there. So I think public participation, both on the front side and within the entities, is something we need to do more of. Knowledge is important as we make our decisions. Our job is to provide information so that the knowledge is there. The decision makers may walk away from the decision, but it is still our responsibility to provide that knowledge. And I'm very proud of what CAPRI has been able to do with their association and all their affiliates to produce such a document, which puts on the front burner some things that are very important. What do I think we need to do going forward? We need to ensure that we continue gathering information, applying pressure, monitoring, modeling, using technology wherever we can to simulate what could happen, what should happen. We no longer have to chop down a tree to know what's going to happen. We can simulate, we can model, we can give you the answers. We can give you 5 different sets of answers. Why don't we do more of our technology drivers so that we can model, and then we mentor. We're doing this now because the generation that's here needs to look at the next generation where environment becomes a part of what they have learned. We had to learn it in school. We had to grow up. But next generation, it's going to be their natural base. We need to leave them, the next generation, a better Jamaica than we had. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Weber. I will now invite Ms. Forrest to please give your remarks.
Thank you very much and good evening. Thank you so much for the invitation to make a few remarks and to participate in what I think is a very, very important discussion in terms of what I would regard as a transformation of our environmental legislative landscape. I think the report was an excellent report. I think it outlines some very painful facts as we examine where we are and what we have achieved over the last 30 years. And I think that anybody would agree that a framework in place for 30 years is probably requires an overhaul. In the context of many things, in the context of what we've been able to achieve with the framework, the gaps that have emerged. In the context that 30 years ago, issues like climate change weren't front and center. And when we examine our environmental framework and all the things that are linked to doing that and addressing some of those issues and addressing changes that we need to see to deal with those matters, they're absent to a large degree in terms of our environmental laws. I think that while we have focused in this discussion, perhaps, and that's maybe not entirely true, a lot on the NRCA, we have about another, as pointed out in the report, 16 bits of legislation related to environment. So that any kind of effective transformation of this landscape is going to have to go beyond looking at the NEPA Act, in my humble opinion, but it's going to have to generally probe to say, hey, where we are with all these things and where we want to go. When the NEPA Act was formed in 1991, the motivation behind it was to pull together some fragmented pieces of legislation. Clearly, that is not going to have to be the objective. But I think as we move to, and I strongly support the need for this environmental change, the transformation in our legislation, as we move towards doing that, we need to decide what is the objective. It cannot be just to put together some fragmented legislation. It has to be the kind of legislation that moves to putting us in a place where it transforms our environmental space. It has to be a kind of legislation that is forward thinking, forward looking, not only looking at the context now, but where we want to be in the next 50 years. It has to be something that will help to drive development, but development that is in harmony with our environment. And so I think this is a lot. I think that as we examine really what are the solutions, it may be beyond a NEPA Act. I also need to say that as a practitioner working in the field and sitting down on certain committees, there's been a great debate in whether planning and environment really should have been married in the first place. Because I think planning has been perhaps somewhat hampered. It has become, I don't want to say poor cousin, but I can't think of any other word right now. And so environment has gotten some precedence. But look at our look at how the level of disorder that we see in terms of development in our society. So I think as we look at that, we need to think about it very carefully. I know my 5 minutes are coming up, but I want to say something else. Despite the weaknesses that we have identified in the existing environmental laws, I believe that the kind of results that we could have achieved would have been possible if we were more effective in using the tools that we had in place. Now tell me, new legislation are going to have permits, aren't they? New legislations are going to have license. We have those now. But how are these tools being used? They're not followed up in many cases. They're not monitored, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So as we look at enhancing the environment, we need to also look in parallel at issues of the institutional capacity, technical and otherwise, organizational structures, to make sure that when this new legislation is unfolded, we have the ability to implement it in a serious way. We could end up with a perfect legislation and yet not the ability to deal with implementing it effectively. And I will say to you now that if we implemented what we had now a little bit more effectively, perhaps the scorecard that we just heard rather sadly would not be quite where it is. Nonetheless, I agree that we need a change. I just want to say something else. It's the elephant in the room, perhaps. I hope they will allow me to stay after I say it. But there is a kind of feeling, I think quite incorrect, that environment and an effective environmental management and take environment on board stymies development. So this is really, you mean we're going to have to do something to look at the environment? Oh, how can we get around that? And so there is this feeling that it is almost like a barrier to promoting and economic growth, and because you have to deal with environmental issues. I'd like to flip that and say the very opposite is true. And because there's this kind of feeling, not backed up by facts, the environment gets pushed around into 19 different ministries. If we can avoid it, we avoid it. If we don't have to do our EIA, we don't do it. And I really believe that there needs to be, as we move towards this environmental legislation, transformation that's required, a change in mindset at every level with respect to how we treat with the importance of environment. We need to recognize that it's essential for our development, and there needs to be a change in mindset at every level. Political leaders, industry leaders, community leaders, we really have to dismiss that, I think, myth and understand how important, how integral to our country it is. So thank you very much for the opportunity to say.
Thank you, Ms. Forrest. And now I'll invite Diana McCauley to give us her response to the findings.
Good evening, everybody. I became interested in the environment in about 1990 maybe. So in a real way, I think of my time as an environmental advocate, I'm the same age as the NRCA Act. And I remember, not really, right? Okay, there was a few years before that, but I remember the excitement that we all greeted the NRCA Act with in 1991 because we thought it was going to make a real difference to how the environment was treated in Jamaica. And that has not happened. Now, I agree with Denise that there are many other statutes. That's one of the problems, right? There are all these different laws and they overlap and they conflict and we can't decide who is to deal with them. But the more I learned about the environment, One professor said to me, you know, once your eyes have been opened to these things, you can't close them. And that's very true. And once your eyes are opened and you can't close them, you live in this world of wounds. So when I drive down Hope Road, you know what I see? I see the air pollution over St. Catherine. When I drive Junction Road, what do I see? The deforestation and the bamboo that has taken over that forest and the pollution in the Wagwater. I'm a very depressing person to live with or go anywhere with. What I want to say about the report is that I hope that we can generate and find a sense of urgency about these issues because we have been talking about them long enough. The things that we are trying to do and have said we are doing for those 30 years are done too slowly, Minister Vaz. We need to speed up the progress that we are making and not have so many good intentions have them completed. Because the situation that faces us is, in fact, urgent. And it is urgent because of climate change. It is because of these changes that are coming fast at us that we are so woefully prepared for. And it is urgent because of the impacts to the public health of our citizens that we are inflicting on people, often the poorest among us, and they have no ability to move away from the pollution source, and they are forgotten by our regulatory agencies. So the situation is urgent. We don't have another 30 years to discuss and to plan and to promise all the things we have been doing for the last 30. There is too much emphasis on process and not outcome. And so one of the things you'll see in the report is a lot of processes have gone on. But when you look around you, and if you ask government agencies, they will tend to respond to you with a long list of processes and things that have been done. But when you look around you, you see this world of wounds that I see every day. So we have to move beyond process and start evaluating outcome and start realizing what a serious situation we are in. Minister Vaz, we need a bipartisan agreement to leave the ministry somewhere. Yes, under your administration, it's been in the office of the Prime Minister, but if the government were to change, in a very unlikely event, of course, you know, it has been moved around by other administrations. And that's what I'd like to see, a bipartisan agreement that this is so critical to our future here that we are going to leave it in whatever spot is decided for at least 10 years. I think if we can do that, we can dig out some of the policies out of the stupor they are in and get them actually to be completed. I'm very fond of... So I worked at JET till the end of last year and retired, and now JET is in the hands of some young people, very excellent young people. Please give them your support. I am very fond of saying to them, I'm glad I'm not young. And in a way, that's true, because I do feel I'm not going to be around to see the worst impacts of what we're setting ourselves up for unless we act very differently starting right now. But in this room are a lot of young people. And the last thing I want to say is this is your fight, right? Environmental regulatory framework, it sounds boring. Who can grapple through this 60 pages of it? But there is nothing more critical for you to consider. These changes that are coming for us, you and your children will see. It's not some far-off thing. So I'm glad I'm not young. But this is the fight for young people now. The place we live, our home place, that we call home, that we say we love and treat in a very different way.
Thank you, Diana. The passion is coming across as always. I would like to invite the other Diana on the panel. If you have any perspectives, any new perspectives based on the responses from our panelists, as well as your own, that you'd like to share?
Well, I would say that being involved in this research was a learning experience for me, and unfortunately, my eyes can't close anymore either. And want to say, we say this in much more detail in the report, but the point that Denise made about enforcing the laws
and following the policies that we already have would take us a far way. So we talk about new this, new that, but if we were not to devise any single new policy or any single new law, we could actually be further ahead. And one last thing I want to say, the point about the NRCA Act binds the Crown. It's a tricky thing, because if you have a National Water Commission that is maintaining sewage plants far below capacity, which it is, because none of the NWC plants meet standards, who is actually going to take action against them? The NRCA is going to sue the Water Commission, and then the Water Commission is going to use resources to defend itself, resources that it didn't use to make the plants be up to standard in the first place. So there's a moral hazard in that binding of the Crown. And it creates a culture of impunity. If state agencies are constantly breaching, then what are private citizens going to do? So that's all I have to say.
Now, as we open up the floor for questions, I just have a few of my own for the audience. How many people in the audience have been in the environmental industry for over a year, or less than a year, rather? Less than a year. How many people have been in the environmental industry for less than 5 years? How many people have been in the environmental industry for 5 years, over 5 years? How many people think that they can moderate this panel? Okay. All right, we have one, two takers. So I actually have a question of my own, and because I see that we have some people here who have themselves some experience within environmental regulatory framework, I'm hoping that some of you would also have some insightful, interesting questions for our panelists. But I would like to ask one of my own. Minister Vaz, I know you're leaving, so I'd like to address this to you. It was said by Dr. Charles that $1 billion has been allocated to NEPA in their budget going forward for the next year. Can you hear me?
No.
No? We're having an issue with the mic?
It's better now.
Can you hear me now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great. Right, it was said that about $1 billion has been allocated to NEPA going forward. And scarcity of resources aside, what do you think is the greatest challenge facing environmental regulators now, today?
The outdated legislation and regulations, which were highlighted earlier. Truth be told, that is not only to do with the environment. Part of why Jamaica is where we are today is because we are acting on outdated legislation in almost every area of governance. And you can't be dealing in 2018 in this day and age, in a world that's moving at this pace, using 1950 and 1960 regulations and legislation. That, accompanied with bureaucracy, is a recipe for disaster. As it relates to the funds, I can indicate that that is something that is always challenging, but as the economy improves and our fiscal situation as it is, we will then be able to start making allocations and using money, getting more funds, both from taxes and, of course, based on our own governance in terms of what we can save. So you can look forward to that. You heard the Prime Minister speak, although it was on a political platform, 100 garbage trucks. We haven't seen 100 garbage trucks in Jamaica probably in the last 2 decades in totality if you put all the years together. So all I'm saying to you is that we, as the economy improves, which it is, we are going to be in a better position and you can look forward. I'll just leave you with one thing, and I'm going to stay a little longer because I'm a minister that likes to be on time. I have a dinner appointment at 7:30, but I'll go at 7:45. The situation, I'll give you a perfect example. I've made an outreach to the Ministry of Finance at Cabinet, and I've gotten support for the next fiscal year. What's that to do? To get $500 million to clean up Riverton City of all the tires that are on the dump, around the dump, and all over Kingston and St. Andrew. We have gotten a situation where we have a private company that's going to take the shredded tires, so it means our cost is going to be subsidized, but that in itself, that one exercise over 12 to 18 months to clean those tires, because you can't truck them, it's prohibitive cost, has to be shredded, and obviously we have to find an end user. So that in itself will be a line item for almost $500 million for that one exercise. What will that do to the air quality, Diana? Can you imagine? How long have we been speaking about that? 20 years? 25 years? The cockpit country. How long have we been speaking about defining the boundaries? 3 decades. And in 2.5 years under Andrew Warner's administration, we have been able to do it to the satisfaction 90% of JET. Still 10%.
Okay,
80. Sorry. 80%. But that's still substantial. So all I'm saying is that, ladies and gentlemen, we realize, and to straddle between development, investment, environment, and climate change, it's not easy. But we turned down a Goat Island project. We turned down a coal plant out at Jisco. So bottom line is that we are very, 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 very sensitive, and it's not investment at all costs. And I am here to tell you and give you a commitment on behalf of the Prime Minister and the government that I'm a part of, that we will work hand in hand with CAPRI and any other organization to see how we can walk between the raindrops in terms of updating the long outdated legislation and regulations and keep Jamaica on the path to prosperity. That's what we have to find, that balance. And I'm prepared to work with you wholeheartedly. So it won't be just another document, another study. We have in every ministry, you could fill an entire room with them. We have more studies, more documents and more papers that have been written on Jamaica and the various industries. We don't need one more. What we need to do is to implement. Thank you.
Okay. Well said. Sounds like we have an excellent commitment on behalf of the government to see some of these recommendations.
And this politician's word, it is bond. I'm sure you have that.
All right. Okay, so now, members of the audience, do we have any questions for our panelists? Okay, I will ask the ushers, would please raise your hand if you have a question, and I will ask the ushers. Okay, great.
Good afternoon, citizens of Jamaica. Equal, one person, one vote. 1944 was not meaningless, or was it? Or 62? I refer you to page 30. 3.6. Oh, pardon me, I am Christopher Liu, a frustrated, gray-haired old person like Diana McCauley, the current president of the Jamaican Institute of Architects. 3.6, the National Physical Plans. In the body of that, it refers to the proposed Environmental Regulatory Authority Green Paper. Question one, Minister, Honorable Minister, what is the status of the Green Paper? If my memory serves me right, having been to Parliament as part of a group that made a presentation to the subcommittee, the Joint Select Committee that was investigating or studying the Green Paper and seeking comments from citizens as advertised in the press, as is per the procedure, the paper spoke to the dissolution of NEPA, the Beach Control Authority, Diana Kenbach can be more accurate in that, and the NRCA, in creating this new overarching entity called Environmental Regulatory Authority. I would invite you to go to the Parliament of Jamaica's website and trawl through there, and you'll find a PDF of this document, all right? That being said, Honorable Minister, what is the status of the Green Paper?
I think it's still green.
Okay, fine. All right. No. A paper that was brought forward under the more recent administration, I believe it was in June or July 2016, post-March or February 25th, 2016. A two-day workshop was held at the Ministry of Finance and Planning's conferencing rooms to look at the national land use policy. A representative of NEPA at the time, when asked by me what was the timeline for this policy to be presented to Cabinet, I was told it would be presented to Cabinet by August 2016. Could you speak to the status of that document?
That document did come to Cabinet. It was referred, and there's some more work being done at it as we speak. I can get an update and give you
that. Could you also speak to the status of the National Housing Policy, which is a draft document under the tenure of then Minister of Housing, the Honorable Horace Chang, in the Bruce Golding administration, was reactivated under Minister of State Maurice Guy under Portia Simpson Miller administration, and is now floating somewhere?
That is in the ministry, but under a different minister. That's under Minister Samuda. So all of that I will check. When I'm finished here, I'll discuss it with you, and I'll get answers for you.
Hold on.
Okay.
You spoke
Remember,
about...
we have other members of the audience who also want to ask allow me, questions. Ma'am. So
this is important, because what you don't know, I know. And I'm sharing with you. And this is information sharing, not speaking to one another, or are we not? There is some inaccuracy which I ask you to investigate. They are speaking of the National Spatial Plan. It refers that it was conceptualized in 2009. That means it was conceptualized in the administration of the Honorable Bruce Golding. It was launched in 2018. I beg to differ. You can consult with the government town planner, the chief executive officer of NEPA, Mr. Peter Knight, who was chief executive officer of NEPA in 2010. Correct? That document or spatial plan was, I believe, funded by the IDB, because Mr. Peter Knight, in his role as government town planner, chaired an oversight committee that met at Jamaica House in the Pineapple Conference Room. I went to several meetings there representing the Institute of Architects. What I can say to you is the process reached a point where RFPs were sent out, bids were received, four bidders were eligible to bid, international bidders. Matt MacDonald was one of them because I was present at the bid.
All right, sir, I would kindly ask you.
No, the question is this. You have an inaccuracy. When you speak of it being launched in 2018, it was launched from 2010 and died and was reactivated with a $175 million grant from NHT to do a national spatial plan.
So there's an inaccuracy in the document.
Very
thank
serious
you.
Inaccuracy.
Thank you for pointing it out. I would ask that if anybody has any specific inaccuracies that they can afterwards speak with Diana, if it's something that's not major, such as an issue with a year that's in the document. I think Diana wanted to respond.
So to just a few of those points, there's a quite extensive list, which is not exhaustive still, on page 28 of all these various policies that are in some kind of draft or limbo state. And it is actually quite difficult to get this information because it's different depending on where you look. So if you go to the Ministry of Justice, you will see a list of policies. If you go to NEPA, you see a different list. So one of the problems we have is that the information that exists to guide us, the public, is really quite inconsistent. But there is a list of these policies. There are a lot of them. The list that is here is not all of them by any means. On the ERA, Mr. Liu, the 2013 State of the Environment report says it's still in progress. But in a very large meeting we had at NEPA with the senior directors, the general feeling there, which is reflected in the report, is that it is not in fact going ahead. As you will remember, there was some opposition to the idea of this new ERA, and there was a wish that we should revert to what was the case before the merger. So I would say at this point, the information we have is that that ERA is not currently on the horizon. So that's what I want to say to what you said. We have a problem with policies that are started, drafted, partly because the ministry changes. There are new priorities. They're just never finished. Even the ones that are finished are ignored.
All right, thank you, Diana. I don't know if any of our other panelists wanted to respond, or if, should we take more questions from the floor? Okay, do we have anyone with any questions? Please, I'll ask that you introduce yourselves before you ask your question, and please keep your questions brief. We're going to try and give everybody a chance to ask their questions. Thank you.
David Smith, I'm the coordinator for the Institute for Sustainable Development at the University of the West Indies. One quick comment. I didn't see where you had mentioned in the report the building code and the promulgation of the building code. I think that's absolutely vital if you're talking about environmental regulation, and that's been a long-standing matter that has yet to go forward. The second point was that there was points made about the lack of baseline data. The only people who can collect those baseline data are really NEPA and possibly the university. When we're looking at the budget for NEPA, we do need to look at the budget for simply collecting information as to where things are and what state they're in. And at the moment, there is not an adequate provision made for simply collecting data. Without the data, it's very difficult for governments to be able to credibly say whether they're making an improvement or not. The third point has to do with where's that money going to come from? Successive governments have not charged sufficient rent for use of our natural resources. Tourism is totally dependent on a healthy coastal environment. We need healthy beaches, we need healthy reefs, seagrass beds, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. In order to incentivize tourism, we've tended to give a discount to people who are in the tourism industry so they can get a free ride off the resources rather than charging them the full amount of rent that they should be paying. So when we get to a situation where people in the Negril are complaining that their beach is running away and then say, well, government must put it back, without getting into the merits of whether government should put it back or not, government would have been able to put it back had government been able to charge the users of the resources the correct amount of rent in the first place. We need to address that because our entire country's economy, to some extent, depends on having a viable tourism industry. We're not maintaining the natural resources which provide all that vast amount of GDP. The guys in Capri can tell you exactly how much in terms of flows comes out of tourism, but it's a minuscule amount of that that goes back to maintaining the resources that generate the income. We have to change that. And to throw out a challenge to the minister, if you could get that done in your particular tenure, then we'd be singing your praises forever. And the last point is just to reiterate the support for Denise's call for divorce. Yes, it definitely seems to me that by marrying environment and planning, it's been a marriage of convenience, and like most marriages of convenience, it hasn't gone well. And we maybe need to start looking at other arrangements, separating the two, getting back to where we can move ahead with planning and also look at environmental management in the context of it really being the bedrock for development and making the two separate so they can achieve what they need to achieve. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Smith, for your insight.
Can I say something about the building?
Okay, so I see we have two of our panelists who wanted to respond to those comments, so I will ask Professor Weber first.
I just want to support David on that. The issue of environmental economics becomes so important because you need to know what it is you're valuing. And what are you going to put a value in it, dollar value, or it's going to be an appreciation value, whatever method you use. Until you know what it's worth or worth to you potentially, you're not going to value it, you're not going to price it. You're therefore in a position to say to a developer, no, you cannot do that. And there should be some things that are beyond development price. There should be some things that you say, we will never go past that point. So we need to get more persons in environmental economics for the valuation of all the environment, for its use, its non-use, and that's something that we need to put on the table. The second thing is we need to do more partnerships. So we know, David knows, at the university, we've decided to partner with NEPA, and we say to NEPA, tell us the next place you want us to go research. And that's how we do a lot of the baseline data collection. But those type of information do cost money. We do it, and we put it out there, but we need more sharing of information so that NEPA and other entities can make the best decision. So I think we need to do a lot more sharing, because there is information, but how do we use it?
Okay, thank you, Professor Weber. And Diana wanted to respond.
Just briefly on the building code, yes, and there is nothing about the Building Act. So this is not a document about every environmental law. So there's nothing in there about the Forestry Act, the Fisheries Act, There's a lot that's not in here. It's focused on the NRCA Act, Town and Country Planning Act, and some of the instruments that those are used. It could be three times the size.
Okay. Ms. Forrest, you wanted to make a comment?
Not only to agree with what David said, but I think that this report opens up an opportunity. We note the recommendations that says we need a NEPA Act. I think what we need to say is we need legislation that deals with environmental management. We need to learn from the lessons that we have looked at for the last 30 years, but we also need to be forward-looking. And that might mean, you know, it could possibly mean that we're not wedded to a NEPA Act, but we're wedded to a change in whatever you want to call it that brings about, as the minister says, more up-to-date legislation that allows us to do what we want to do. And perhaps what may also happen from there is that instead of every time somebody says, there's a problem, and we say, let us prepare a policy. That's our usual response, which is why we have the list of policies. Incomplete, ineffective, because they're just not, we're not able to use them. So I really think that we need to use this as a base to examine what exactly is it that we need. And it may not be a NEPA Act per se, but something that might be beyond that and may take a different shape or form, but is leading us to where we need to go.
Okay, thank you for that. All right, ushers, I see we have some questions here in the middle. I think this gentleman had his hand up first.
My name is Aaron Spiro. I've been involved with the environment for my work.
I'm sorry, could you just speak into the mic? If you could speak a little up, having it.
My name?
Yes.
Can you hear me better?
Hello?
The mic is on
yes,
now?
That's better. Yes, that's better. Thank you.
Depends which side I'm talking to it. I'm sorry. I've been in the natural environment from where I was born. And then I was born into the man-made environment. We have to differ between the two. The natural environment has a carrying capacity that takes in the built-in environment. We either wholesomely protect our natural environment, or we can become very destructive to it. If 50% of our population in Jamaica is currently in squatter settlement, that means that whatever land use plans we may promulgate are notwithstanding unless we create a situation, an economic situation, as Professor Weber said, where we protect our environment from destruction. There's a problem, there is a correlation direct between the environment and development. Development has to take place within the environment, which it does by nature. We have to protect very sensitive and fragile areas of the environment to protect ourselves, our health, and our well-being from any destructive tendency that we may inadvertently, by ignorance, create by building within the natural environment. What the minister said about the laws are very important. As I have originally worked in the Natural Resources Conservation Authority and Malliance Road in the 70s, and then in Town Planning Department, and some of us were instrumental of bringing the two together. But it doesn't work because the laws that we have here are antiquated and they need changing. I welcome the report. I think it's a very healthy one and very significant. And I think that we have to be more accurate in what we are doing, particularly in view of climate change and the sensitivity of tropical areas to climate, which will affect that adversely, whether we like it or not. And we have to make sure that not only legislation, but implementation takes place. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that comment. All right, ushers, I'm not sure who I saw first. There's a, okay, there you go.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
I was watching the TV the other day, and as they were showing our landscape view of our Carlisle sits, my sits. I was watching the TV the other day, and as they were showing our landscape view of what will take place by the year 2030, I became so, you know, in tune. And when I see the opportunity that comes up here, you know, it really took a hold on me, because I wanted to come and share my concern that they were turning in that by the year 2030, that we will soon lose this beautiful island called home due to climate change. But because the ice up north is melting, and that will contribute, they said by the year 2013, this whole island will be flooded out. And they were showing the view on the TV. And I was so shocked and frightened. So I'm asking this evening, as you know, sitting say, we are concerned, sitting say, what can we do to save our island? We know the mangrove, we know we can plant more trees. Can we clean the mangroves to save it? What can we do to save our environment? Thank you.
Okay, so that question seems to be, what are the most critical changes that we can make for a more effective future in a changing climate?
Can I comment on one thing that she said? I think.
Ms. Forrest, and then I would also then ask Professor Weber
you first,
and then Professor Weber, please.
I think one of the things that, thank you very much for your comment, that your comment raised that we had mentioned before, is that we speak, and one of the answers to what can we do, is that we say that we have public consultation. But in truth and in fact, any kind of action that we hope to achieve through legislation or policies is going to require, along with it, true and authentic dialogue with the public,
public education,
as well as educating them, because their actions is going to what is going to help to make the legislation or the policies work. So one of the things that we absolutely must do, and we haven't done enough of, is really effective public participation and public dialogue. We have public consultations where we invite people into the room. We tell them what we are going to do, which is really sharing public information, but not really having an authentic dialogue and reaching a stage where people buy and engage and really become part of it. The other matters related to how we're going to deal, I'm going to turn over to Prof. Webb, because, you know, and then we can get back to it. But I think that that is an important part of everything that we're talking about here, a thread that must.
Okay. Thank you. And Professor Webber.
Well, let me start by saying, don't panic. And what you've just described there, I guess it would be alarming, but there's no data I have seen and no models I have seen which say that the island is going to disappear by 2030. Sea level rise is real, and we are having coastal erosion, but the island is not going to disappear by 2030. So let me put that to rest for you. But what can you do? Okay, so there's, within the whole aspect of climate change, there is mitigation and adaptation. And there are various things that are happening in various levels, and education is a part of that. But if you wanted to do something, you could say, what can I do to reduce my carbon footprint? What can I do to reduce how much I am changing the atmosphere, and share that with everybody so there's a multiplier effect and they can do the same thing? And then say to the government, let's see what we can do to reduce our impact in terms of climate change. And then within your community, what are you going to do? Well, protection of the environment is always the best thing. So you protect, you conserve. You can only conserve that which you know about. So we need to get the education again there. So we need to keep what we have. But if we do lose, then we need to try and restore. So we need to determine, okay, are we going to replant? Are we going to regenerate? Are we going to put things back in place as the way they were? And There are ways that we can get that done as well. But finally, I'd say, in all of that, we need to get the education at the point where you understand what you can do and recognize that individuals make a difference. Many people say, I can't make a difference. Well, I'm here to tell you, you can make a difference because there are many of you all over here.
Thank you, Professor Weber. Excellent. And then I would like to invite Minister Vaz, who has portfolio responsibility for climate change issues.
Yeah. Just to say, I agree 100% with Professor Weber in terms of the partnership that needs to extend to every living citizen from Negril Point to Moran Point. It's the only way that we're going to get a real buy-in and any success in any policy to do with the environment or climate change. Just to say that for me, the document here, Diana, is a base document. It's good to discuss and, of course, sensitize, but it's a bigger picture for me as the minister responsible. And what I'd like to suggest before leaving is that we do set up, as we have done before with Capri, some kind of working group to look at this document and to come up with an action plan with actions and timelines. Because without that, this document will become another document that has seen the light of day. For it is so fundamental and so important that if we can pick out some of the low-hanging fruits in it and get them implemented while working on the more tedious ones that are going to take some more time. But for me, having stakeholders like yourself, along with the government apparatus, is the only way that I think that we'll be able to undo some of what is in here in terms of the missed timelines. And I think that is a golden opportunity. And I'm more than happy to work and have a working group ongoing until such time as we can start to see some successes. So thanks very much for inviting me, and I hope to return to the table in short order. Thanks very much.
Before you go, Minister, I want to say something to the young lady that I want you to hear, okay?
Okay.
Tell
you know, you're my boss, second boss.
Yep.
I like to keep
I'm
on
sorry,
your good
I didn't
side.
Get your name, but tell your elected representatives that you are concerned about the environment and you will not vote for them if they do not have good environmental
policies. What parish you come from
here?
What? Where's the lady? St. Andrew. Constance Spring.
You know who to talk to, Minister.
I'll pass that message on very shortly to your elected representative. But on a serious note, you're correct. Environment is now a big ticket item.
Okay. Thank you, Minister Vaz. All right, I saw two questions. There's a gentleman there in the middle, and then over there, there's a lady who had her hand up, Ms. Stanley.
Long time.
And we have two other there. So let's try that order, okay?
Hello, good night. My name is Rashane Winter. I'm in the engineering field. My concern, and I'm so happy that Denise Forrest touched on it, was the public dialogue, right? I remember the whole public movement of saving the cockpit country. And it was so powerful because I think it spoke the language of the people. The way that it was driven about, the way that it was spread, you know, using social media, using all of that, I think it was the power behind it, right? But then when it comes down to now, the other projects that have environmental impact, and I can lay out one that I am personally touched with is the, you know, like the major project right now, the MIDP project. They have the Constant Spring going along Constant Spring. It is I don't know how to describe it. Yes, terrible might be a good adjective to use, but it's just that. What language, what does the public have to do? Or is it that the communication between the public and the project manager, the managers, the government authorities, what does the public need to do to get across that this is a problem, and why isn't it like as powerful at some time as the movement of the cockpit country, saving the cockpit country? Yeah, that is my question there.
Okay, thank you. That sounds like a question for the advocate. Diana, do you have some ideas on that?
I have a lot of ideas, but I don't want to say all of them. But the next time you read something in the newspaper or on social media that interests you, right? And you see there's a whole lot of response to it, you know, lots of likes, shares, comments, that kind of thing. Look at what the topic is, right? And it's hardly ever the environment. You'll see an environment story, some dreadful disaster that's coming, 3 comments, right? That is your job as a young person. People listen to people they know and trust, right? So if you're concerned and you can get your friends, look at this thing, let's all sign the petition, make a post, write a letter to the minister. All of these things work. I spent a lot of time going to public meetings, and Denise is right. They are deeply flawed in their planning and in their execution. But there's typically far more state agencies at a public meeting than members of the public. I have been to a public meeting where I was the only member of the public, right? We've got to turn out for these things.
Yeah.
If we do not have rights if we're not prepared to assert them. And that means going to boring meetings and sitting through them and putting up your hand just as you have done today and challenging the people at the front. Yeah. Who are all telling you it's going to be fine. We cannot have a vibrant civil society if we do not participate in it. So that is your job, young person.
Okay, then, and there are some words of advice for young people. I don't know, Diana.
I was doing some research on Jamaica's and the behavior of the Jamaican people when it comes to dealing with matters of public participation. And we have perhaps not as strong an ethic in this as we would like to. Within the environmental sector, which is, huge, first of all, we need to, besides your action, I really do believe that we're gonna have to do some messaging that allow people to understand the linkage between environment and their everyday lives in order to move them to a position that when they come to the environmental meeting, rather than discussing, as has been my experience, the issue we want to discuss, they talk about potholes and they talk about other
jobs.
Things. Why? Because we haven't done enough of the education part. So it's going to be a push and pull thing. But what I can say is, as you have said in the case of the cockpit country, there is a great deal of power and agency in people and the individuals. If we were just to understand the nature of that problem and turn it on, I think that would help us to move in the directions that we need to move.
Thank you. And Diana Thorburn, Capri has had some expertise and some success in using research as an advocacy tool. Do you have any insights that you want to share to members of the public?
Well, this is exactly the type of way in which we try to inform and motivate the public to act. And we would like to think that coming out of a forum like this and a report like this, that we would be able to, in helping to explicate some of the issues, then people would have a better idea of where to put their action and where to direct their actions. I think that was one of the main purposes of us trying to do this work, because going into it, we ourselves weren't clear. We just knew that there was a problem, but we ourselves didn't understand until we actually got the research going and were able to explore it. And so I think our role is to be doing exactly what we are doing here.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
All right, and here we have a lady with a question. Please introduce yourselves.
Yes. Good evening, mm-hmm. everybody. I'm Norma Press. I'm from Portland. I was once Mr.
Nice
Buzz
place.
From D left. Living in Kingston now. What is my account? Before I start, I'm a proud volunteer of JET for 6 years now. It's not kind of familiar with me, but Tamoya Sings know me well. She always called me like 2 weeks before, every September, and said, Norma, Miss Price, beach cleanup coming up. Are you available? I said, yes. And I never hesitate, and I never said no to Tamoya Singh. I'm doing volunteer now for 6 years.
Thank you.
I'm a proud volunteer of JET.
Thank you.
Okay, excellent. Did you have a question that you wanted to ask the panel?
Yeah, I want to ask another question. What I'm saying, I think somebody from West Indies should be here, or DNG, because they are the most buckle hard about the place. You don't think so? Somebody should be here from that company. Don't miss. You don't think so? Okay.
Sorry, if I could just say, to be fair to West Indies, they have been one of the leaders in the recycling program, and we're very proud of our cooperation and their participation in that effort.
Or from DNG.
Okay, the plastic bottles. Okay, thank you.
Yeah,
so more a comment, but not really a question. Thank you so much. All right. So do we have more questions? I think you had your hand up. Did you have questions?
It was more of a comment, actually.
Wait, hold on. Can we get the microphone?
Oh, I'm so loud, though.
It was actually more of a comment. See?
I'm so loud.
And, you know, it was really, I like the discussion this evening. It's very kumbaya, you know, as Dana would say, it's kind of a come home to Jesus moment, probably. But communication is a two-way street, and I've heard, you know, public participation and encouraging public participation, and we all need to turn out and things. But it's a two-way street, right? And my experience since taking over JET from Dana earlier this year has been one of a wall. It's a wall of there's a wall between the public and getting information from the government. There's a wall that exists when we're trying to engage in dialogue with government agencies. So this is beyond NEPA. This goes to, you know, I was in the forestry department, cockpit country sensitization meeting today. And it's like and I think that I haven't read the study in detail, but the lack of information is a major hurdle for citizens, for groups like JET. I'm sure it was probably a hurdle for Capri in trying to put together this study itself. And it's as if information is being held by the government close to the chest, as if it is something that should never be released and never be shared. And I just wanted to make that comment that, you know, it is one of the major hurdles that, you know, we as citizens have. So the dialogue needs to be open both ways. And that's just really my comment.
All right, thank you. We only have about 5 minutes left. So what I would suggest is that we take a few questions first, and then we get a response from the panelists before we do it one-one. There's a lady who had her hand up for a very long time here. Could you please?
Hello, my name is Natalie Johnson. I went back to school because I had an interest in looking at economics. And it is brought up multiple times today that you need to put a dollar figure to things to make you actually make impact. And while I was doing my studies, I went back to school to UWE. I had interest in a couple pet projects. So I managed to squeeze the environment into my economics classes. And a lot of discussion has come out about the bottles, for example. And one of my pet projects was looking at how to use plastic waste for infrastructure development. And I wondered how much of this was in consideration when these new policies were being put in about pet bottles. Because other parts of the world, including developing and developed countries, have been using plastic to create roads and to create housing and use them in very innovative ways. And especially when it comes to road development, Jamaica's economic development, it depends on a better road network, whether you're trying to bring goods in or out of a community. And these environmentally sensitive roads using recycled plastic cut the amount of plastic waste that the country has to deal with. They create roads that are cheaper to build, last longer, uphold to the heat better. And there's literally thousands of kilometers of pavement in India right now based on recycled plastic, from plastic bags, the scandal bags, to actual bottles. And I wondered if any of this had been in consideration, including also the tires we just heard the minister talk about, using the chopped up tires, shredded, and then turning them into roads. Another pet peeve of mine is when you look at coconut. The coconut fibers were used historically to tie together boards to make dhows for them to travel across from Asia into Africa to collect spices, because the coconut fiber is water resistant. So can you imagine if we actually did some research at UWE at using coconut resistant fibers in our road systems so that we'd actually have roads that withstand our weather and don't fall apart in 2 minutes. And then the last thing about research is that when you look at other parts of the world that realize that plastic bottles are a problem, they're putting innovative research into seaweed, into cassava, to make all these different plastic products. And we can grow those things here. So you have a market that could produce products not just for Jamaica, but for the world. They're looking for more environmentally friendly solutions. And then another little pet project I had while I was studying was, we talked about dialogue and public participation. One of the things I was interested in is, how do we actually create two-way dialogue using social media? Because right now, the government uses the social media just to put out information. How do you actually have a dialogue to get information back into the government? And when you look at the youth, when you look at where the internet is going, you look at internet use, you look at social media use, it is a viable way to get young people engaged. And there actually are innovative ways that other governments are using to actually get feedback back into the government. So one, I'm available to talk to anyone if anyone would like to see any of my research. But two, I wanted to know specifically what we're doing about using plastic in innovative ways. And it also ties back to the Gentleman Sustainable Institute who talked about the building code, because we need to get the building code to accept such innovation to be able to do something about it.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Yes, so I would like now our panelists to respond. Diana wanted to respond first. And then while we are responding as well, I would like you to also consider a question I have as your final closing thoughts. Are you optimistic or pessimistic about the future of our environment and ability to regulate activities that may have an adverse impact, and why? So, optimistic or pessimistic, and why?
Okay. Just on the plastic, though, the efforts that are currently underway are largely to collect the plastic. Once you collect them, once you bring them back to wherever, whether it is a plastic facility or many different ones across the island, they are then available to do that kind of project. The hurdle right now is the collection of the plastic. It's diffuse all over the island. It's in gullies, it's in dumps, it's in people's homes. So I think if we can get that going, where the plastic comes back to a place, those things become possible. Right now, any entrepreneur who wanted to do that would have to drive around the country collecting the plastic, and it would make it infeasible. There are many, I can't say much about the other things you've mentioned, because there are many initiatives like that on the way. Hopefully, again, I have this sense of urgency that I want to communicate. You know, hopefully we can fast track some of it.
I don't think you should start with me about optimist or pessimist.
All right. How about we start from that end then? Diana.
Well, I have very young children, so I have to be optimistic, because I would not be able to move forward. And not only because, you know, of a blind optimism. For me, the example of the cockpit country was very encouraging, that something actually happened on an issue that I don't think any of us, and I don't even count myself as an environmentalist, but I was shocked and happy that what happened happened. And for me, that type of an achievement means that we can do that more. And I think, you know, the wall is there. It's definitely there. As a citizen living near Constance Springs, seeing the 100-year trees chopped down and trying to get some answers from the National Works Agency, that was a depressing experience. They treated us, the citizens, like we had no say at all. They totally disregarded us, didn't even show up to some of the meetings. So those are definitely challenges, but I think that we can, we have shown we can, and I think that with more mobilization, more awareness, sorry to say it, but social media helps a lot, that I think we'll be able to do better. Okay.
Thank you. Professor Weber, optimistic, pessimistic?
On your comments, there's a lot of plastic recollection happening. What we do with it, there's a lot of question marks about that. And as the price of oil changes, plastics being from an oil derivative, that changes as well. And that's changed a lot of what we have done with collection. You would know there's a large collection happening at UWI, UTEC, at most of the schools. But what do we do with it after that? So we can talk. Am I optimistic? I'm always optimistic. I'm optimistic because this discussion today wouldn't have happened 20 years ago. This report, I mean, I can look at some of my students in here and say, didn't we have this discussion about how many times we've changed the Minister of National Security versus Environment? Tovia, haven't we had this discussion from 20 years ago? But it's now in print. It's now in your face. It's now common reading. And everybody has a chance to pick up on the information. And there's a greater awareness. And I feel that there are more people engaged. It's become more commonplace. Environment used to be for a few. Now it's more commonplace. I think we are the vanguard that move it to the next stage. Revolutions come, not when things are at their worst, but when things start to change, but not changing fast enough. We need to push that revolution.
Thank you. Well said. Okay, Denise, do you have any comments on the plastic?
I would say yes, we can. Of course I'm optimistic. I don't want to just say I'm optimistic. I want you to understand that this is a complex issue, that they're going after trade-offs. But I think Jamaica has the capacity in our people. And I think that, in truth, our future depends on it. So I'm optimistic. I want us, fellow citizens of this country, to move from implementation inertia, which we suffer from strongly, I must admit, but that's going to be behind us, right? Because we can do it, but we need to understand that it's not going to be an easy road, that there are going to be some bumps on the way, but it is possible, and not only it is necessary, and the time for it is now. So I'm so happy to see you all here, mobilized and ready to be part of that movement. That's going to make a difference.
So, Donata Obama, we are the change we have been waiting for.
Okay, thank you, panelists, and Diana.
So I used to...
All right, well, panelists, can Ms. McCauley please finish her thoughts, and then I will give you my time, because I have to make concluding thoughts. I'll give you my time to ask your question. Okay.
So I used to spend a lot of time standing up in classrooms talking to kids about the environment, and often the subject of the state of the school, which was often full of litter, would come up. And I'd say to them, you know, there's a garbage bin there. You know, why don't we, do you like how the place looks? And they'd all say, no, it was terrible. And then I'd say, well, there's a garbage bin there, you know. Wouldn't it be better if we all just use the garbage bin? And half of the kids in the room would say, you know, yes, miss, we can do that. We can do better. And the other half of the kids in this school would say, this is Jamaica, it's not ever going to happen. So I fall in the people that think, yes, things can happen. We can lose garbage bins. And so that is the optimistic part of me. I'm not always optimistic, though, Dale. Sometimes there's no reason for optimism when you see the things that happen. And then I want to say, the last thing I want to say is the best advice a professor ever gave me was this: hope is not a strategy. So we're not going to get anything done by hoping for it. We have to organize. We have to implement. We have to show up. We have to inform ourselves. We have to not take no for an answer when the NWA doesn't turn up at a meeting. We have to know what our rights are and be prepared to assert them. There's a lot of work ahead.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, panelists. And then I would like to ask, could you please introduce yourself? There's a lady there who has a burning, urgent question. Thank you.
Yes, good evening. I don't have a question. I just have some comments. My name is Jacqueline Da Costa, and I have been involved in land environment planning, etc., for the past 30 years or more.
Since we're at the very end, could you please be concise? I don't want to interrupt you, but please be concise with your comment. Thank you.
I will try to be. Okay. I do not really think that the majority of people in in the political field have been serious about environment. And there are many things discussed here today. I hear people talking about plastic. We had a large committee in my ministry which dealt with glass, plastic, and styrofoam. And decisions were recommended whereby the assess would be charged when all these things were coming in and with the people who made them locally. And that this cess would go towards solid waste collection as well as recycling of some of these things. And among the products we suggested was using it on roads, etc., as well as making plastic hangers, yam sticks, because a million trees or branches are cut every year to grow yam in Jamaica. When the thing went to the finance ministry, they took all the money and gave it to solid waste. Nothing was given for environment. We recommended that they charge $1 so that we could have some money to spend on the environment, as other countries in the region are doing. It was said that we couldn't have it because they were charging cess on airport development, etc. And in fact, a few years later, a recommendation was made that $10 be charged and it would go to tourism. Not for helping in dealing with the things, which was the reason why we had tourism here. And nothing went to the environment. They added $10 to that after that and handled by TEF, and still a lot of things are not being done about the environment. So you're killing the goose that is lays the egg. I want to say that, you know, on the matter of legislation, I personally chaired in 2002, I think it was, and invited all the professionals and everybody concerned, government agencies, civil society, etc. And that was about the sixth time that I was involved in a revision or a redoing of the Town and Country Planning Act. Up to today, there is no new act. And in fact, all the work that was done was set aside. And I don't even know, as one of the people who know most about planning acts in the world, I don't even know what is in the act.
Okay. Mr. Cuss, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but we really are out of time, and I see you're going into several issues. So I don't know if you want to just say what is the one burning thing on your mind, and then we can close.
One of the burning things on my mind is that there are many things that we could do for ourselves on our own. And we figure that if we don't get an external consultant to do it, that it cannot be done.
Okay.
We have a lot of information available. We have a lot of bright people around. And a lot more could be done if we want to do it and if we have the will to do it.
Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Costa, for that. I will just say one thing. As somebody who has been working in this field for a few years and reading this document, the same thing or the same situation scenario that we had 10 years ago is what we're faced with now. And we seem to progress very slowly when it comes to changing the environmental regulatory framework. I was very heartened by Minister Vaz's words about establishing a working group and partnering with CAPRI and other persons in moving forward in some of these recommendations. And I would invite everybody here to read this report in detail. It's very insightful. And let us hope, I am optimistic, let us hope that we'll finally have a future where we enact things and we act and we implement, as Minister Vaz said. So thank you, everyone, and thank you, panelists. Please.
CAPRI is an affiliate of the UWI, and we are truly grateful to the UWI for supporting our work, our research, our evidence-based research over the past few years. And I believe I can confidently say that under Professor Weber's tenure, the relationship and partnership between CAPRI and UWI will continue. The UWI has provided us with office space, as well as financial resources to supplement our budget. So we are truly appreciative, Prof. Ebo, and we look forward to a continued mutually beneficial relationship. This is the end of our discussion in this room this evening. We want to thank you for being here with us, for participating in the discussion. We want to thank our panelists for their expertise and their insight. And we invite you to continue the discussion on social media with us. And we at Capri will definitely do our part to advocate for change and the recommendations to be implemented that we're proposing in our report. Thank you so much, and we invite you to join us for cocktails at the back of the room. Have a great evening.